To catch a killer of 543 ferry passengers, an agent, Doug, and team use a technology that can peek through the space-time continuum and witness the moments leading up to the crime. Can this technology do even more? What if they stop the killer at any point before he succeeds? Will manipulating time do even more damage? Let's see the twists of fate they encounter as they dare try. Here we go. As the movie opens, it is Mardi Gras, Fat Tuesday in New Orleans. Hundreds of Navy sailors with their families are boarding a ferry heading toward the celebrations. Security on the ship notices an SUV with an explosive device in the back, but before he can send an alert, it detonates, exploding the entire ship. People are jumping into the water. There are flames everywhere. This horrible act will wind up claiming 543 souls on board. Later, ATF, Alcohol, Tobacco, and Fire, Agent Doug Carlin, arrives on the scene as rescue attempts are still in progress. He calls for surveillance from all angles surrounding the Crescent City Bridge. As he is searching the debris on the shoreline, he finds the plastic trigger. Later, he meets FBI agent Paul Prizwara under the bridge and shows him the blast residue of ammonium nitrate under the bridge, indicating this was an attack and it was set intentionally. As the team is watching the CCTV footage, they see a man on a bicycle stop and do something on the bridge exactly the time the explosive device went off. The sheriff calls Doug Carlin about a female's body showing signs of burning and explosion damage found on the riverbank, only it was discovered hours before the explosion. Doug goes to the coroner for the autopsy and sees no fingers on her right hand, or perhaps they were blasted off and her face was duct taped. They learn her name was Claire Kuchever. She was a no-show at picking her father up from the airport. Doug interviews the father and learns she had an ex-fiance, but she was going on a blind date last night. At Claire's apartment, Doug looks through her belongings and spelled out on the refrigerator is, "You can save her" message. But it's ambiguous about what that is about. There are bloody rags in the sink and the wastebasket. While checking her phone messages, there is a message from him calling her back that morning after the blast. The evidence shows the explosion was set off from an SUV, much like the one Claire was selling, and the chemicals to make it were found on her body. So they surmise the attacker probably abducted her before the blast to get her SUV. Doug notices his partner Larry Minuti's car and asks where he is. But the other officers tell him those are the cars of the victims from the ferry blast parked at the dock. FBI agent Paul is consoling Doug. He asks if he wants to join their team, the Ferry Task Force, because he's smart, local, quick to observe things, and he wants to give him the chance to find his partner's killer. Doug agrees. Later, they use FBI unique surveillance monitors that can go 4 days into the past and see everything from all angles. And no one has used this unique surveillance to look for lottery numbers or football scores yet? However, due to all the energy needed from satellites, it cannot rewind and only works on that view they have chosen to look at in the past. But this secret technology sees and hears everything. Doug Carlin tells them to look at Claire Kucheva's apartment and this will lead them to the killer. So the team zooms in on Claire, they can see where she is looking, and now they are trying to find how she is connected to the suspect, but all views are 4 days behind, so they must wait in real time. Currently, there are detectives in her house who call Doug and say he should have worn gloves while he was there. The place is full of his fingerprints. But Doug was wearing gloves? While they are watching her take a shower, she senses someone is watching her and goes out to look around. But how can this be? It is the past, or is it? You better buckle up, because here we go again. They are watching all that Claire says and does. They all think it is a shame that such a sweet, kind, beautiful woman will be killed in a horrific way in the near future. I don't think I'd want that job. Someone calls, asking to buy the SUV, and all guess this must be the first contact with the killer. The killer says they must meet Monday night so he can buy the car for Tuesday, but after giving him her address to see the car, she says she can't make it Monday. The FBI can zoom in on the traced call, and it is a phone booth, and although facial recognition software cannot see his face, they zero in on his bag and see the exact bag was near the ferry 2 days from then. While watching Claire from 4 days earlier, he shines a laser pointer at the monitor, and she reacts to it, as if it is happening in the present. The whole system crashes as though they have breached some space-time continuum. Doug asks what this technology really is, and they admit they haven't been honest with him about their equipment, as Shanti explains it scientifically. It was discovered accidentally while trying to increase satellite telescope range by giving extra bursts of energy. The result was it actually folded the fabric of space, like creating a mini wormhole, but only by 4 days. Since its discovery was a quirk and the metaphysics behind it is not fully understood, they are all afraid to use it for anything more than surveillance. Doug asks, is Claire alive? They tell him, you went to her funeral, but in essence, technically, she is alive in the fold of time. So, light can go backwards in time, but will physical matter? It is explained that once beamed back, all life ceases to exist because the electrobiological processes stop, and complex molecules can break down. Are you still with me? It has been tried with flies and rats, and they all died. Gunners points out that if it has a small enough mass, something like paper can. Dr. Alexander states that you cannot change the past. It is linear, and everything that has already happened must happen. But Shanti points out that theoretically, time is like a river, and with a big enough force, you can change the course of a river. A river, like time, will still move forward, but along a different path. The old path then will cease to exist. Okay, sounds good. Let's give it a whirl. Doug suggests sending a note back to himself telling him to apprehend an attacking suspect at the dock with great caution when they know he will be there with the bag. They put the plan into play and send it through the electron machine, and they see Doug with Manuti in the office, and they try to put the paper on the table, but it doesn't materialize until after Doug leaves. Manuti finds the paper and decides to go to the dock and investigate. They can see the encounter at the dock happening, and Manuti confronts the attacker, who shoots him down. Why not bring backup? It said, great caution. He is still alive, and as the killer drives away, he is moving out of range. But there is a mobile goggle rig in a Hummer that can go directly to where the events took place. Since Gunner is busy, Doug will use them to chase the suspect, with the rest guiding him. The view is of the past, so it is hard to drive. Doug causes major traffic accidents trying to follow the SUV. Hey, keep your eyes on the road. This is not a video game. His Hummer is in bad condition and the goggles only work at the monitor. He arrives at the Bayou dock, which in the past was in good shape, but in the present shows a major explosion and much damage. Doug stares upon a charred bloodstain. The goggles reproduce the murder as Manuti has terrible things done to him for all to witness. Did they change the past? Actually, they realize that Manuti rendered his original truck unusable, so now the attacker must approach Claire for her truck. They now have a name and address for the killer, Carol Orstad. There is a boat chase, but they apprehend him, and now Doug begins his interrogation. Carol claims to be a patriot and has delusions of grandeur. Doug uses tactics that stroke the culprit's ego, and it works, as Carol gives detailed confessions to everything. He says his motive was based on fate. He claims to have seen what is coming, and this freedom fighter is part of his destiny, and whoever tries to stop it from happening will cause it to happen. The FBI is shutting the investigation down. As they dismantle the surveillance, there is a memorial reading off all the names of the 543 victims of Carol Orstad. But Doug cannot let Claire die. He blames himself and wishes there was a way to change it. He remembers the letters on her refrigerator and the prints and believes he may have traveled back before. He asks Dr. Alexander for a favor to be sent back. He realizes that all life functions will stop, so they beam him to an ER with a message for the doctors to revive him. It works, and he is able to steal an ambulance and race to the Bayou dock to save Claire. Everything he learned in the autopsy is about to happen to Claire, but he intercepts Carol and moves her to safety just as Carol blows up the dock. He gets shot in the process and takes Claire back to her home to get cleaned up. She mistrusts him, holds him at gunpoint, but calls the ATF office to confirm his identity, the call he received that morning before the blast went off. Claire helps bandage his wounds. The emotions they feel for each other are growing stronger. He has only an hour to get to the dock and defuse the explosion. it is safer for her to come with him. They cannot alert the authorities because that will only trigger Carol to detonate the attack immediately. If he is prevented, he will only find another act to fulfill. It is his destiny. They must catch him red-handed and defuse the device without him knowing. At the dock, he leaves Claire to alert the police once the ferry has sailed. Doug is going to the SUV to defuse it. But Carol notices his old car and knows he's been compromised, so he boards the ferry to make sure his act succeeds. Claire sees this and jumps on the ferry to stop him. No one is allowed near the cars while the ferry is in motion, but Doug climbs through a porthole to get there. Meanwhile, Claire is lurking through the cars, but Carol catches her. When security approaches Carol, he shoots him dead, and as other military people on board hear the shots, it turns into an all-out shootout. Meanwhile, Claire has been tied to the steering wheel of the explosive vehicle. Doug tries to talk Carol down using words from their future interrogation. Waste of time. Can't reason with a psychopath. Just then, Claire hits the accelerator, crushing Carol between two cars, and Doug shoots him before he can hurt anyone else. Doug goes to defuse the explosion and set Claire free, but the authorities will have none of that and tell them to exit the car. If they do, the device will explode, killing everyone on board, so Claire drives off the ferry and into the water. They only have a minute before the blast goes off. Doug is able to free Claire, but he cannot escape in time. Deep underwater, the device goes off but misses the ferry, and the only casualty is Doug. Police retrieve Claire from the water and tell her an officer will be here to ask questions. Special Agent Doug Carlin approaches, and she reacts surprised. He asks if they have met, and she replies, yes. He takes her to his car and is having a moment of deja vu. Claire says to him the same thing he said earlier. What if you had to tell someone the most important thing in the world, but you knew they'd never believe you? And he kind of remembers. Everything has turned out all right. So, what do you think of this little time travel movie? How was Doug in two places at the same time? Let us know in the comments below. If you'd like to watch more on Movie Shortens, please click on our next videos and playlist on the screen. And please don't forget to like and subscribe to the channel. Thanks for watching. Where the freaks at?